In previous videos, we talked about some of the different perspectives in psychology, and I mentioned how some of those perspectives, like functionalism and structuralism, are really more historical perspectives. And then other perspectives, like the psychoanalytical theory, are kind of the bridge between purely historical and more modern perspectives. Well, in this video, we're going to talk about those perspectives in psychology that are very much so part of the modern science. Specifically, we're going to talk about behaviorism, cognitive psychology, and humanism, which really are the three main pillars of the modern science of psychology. We'll start with behaviorism. And behaviorism is really the oldest of these three. In fact, it can trace its roots all the way back to a man named Ivan Pavlov in the latter part of the 19th century. Ivan Pavlov is a very famous individual, very famous doctor that we're going to talk about when we go into the videos with learning, and especially classical conditioning. What he is best known for is an experiment that he did on digestion, believe it or not, right? It wasn't even based on anything really psychology related. And indeed, Ivan Pavlov was a medically trained doctor. He wasn't a psychologist. What he found, though, was that he could basically train dogs to salivate on command, which is pretty amazing because your ability to produce saliva isn't really something we're consciously aware of. But Pavlov was able to actually control it. What that opened was this perspective in psychology that later psychologists like John Watson and B.F. Skinner and Albert Bandura were able to explore further, and that's behaviorism. At its core, behaviorism is focused on the idea of observable actions, behaviors, on things that are visible. In some ways, you can think of behaviorism as the modern manifestation of functionalism, because functionalism also had more of that focus on what was observable, what was visible. So too does behaviorism. Now, there's many different types of learning that we do, and this is an area where sometimes it gets a little bit tricky, because when I say learning, most people probably don't necessarily associate that with a behavior, but really at its core, behaviorism is extremely associated with learning. Now, another misconception people have is when I say learning, you probably picture like maybe what you're doing now or somebody reading a book, right? Like actively studying. But that's not really what I mean when I say learning, and that's not really what behaviorism is focused on. The type of learning that behaviorism is focused on is sort of like how you learned how to behave the way you behave, how you learned how to act, how you learned to associate certain, you know, behaviors as being masculine or feminine, or how to behave when you're in public, like social customs and norms, right? So it's a much larger context of that term learning. And behaviorism is really especially focused on learning, but learning in that manner. Now, early in psychology's history, behaviorism and psychoanalytical perspective were really the two main dominant forces in psychology, and that really remained through to about the middle part of the 20th century. Now, I did mention in previous video that the psychoanalytical perspective is still around. It's just been changed quite a bit from Freud's days. And that is very much true. Psychoanalytical perspective is a big part of the modern science. However, it has a little bit more of a diminished role. That diminishment in its role started to happen in about the mid part of the 20th century. And what really fueled it was something that I talked about in that earlier video about Sigmund Freud. And that's that a lot of the things he came up with, like even the root idea of a conscious versus unconscious, are difficult and in some cases impossible to prove through the scientific method. So in that respect, some things that Freud came up with, you could almost make an argument as being more like a philosophy than a science. So beginning about the mid part of the 20th century, there was a big push in psychology to move away from a lot of Freud's theories and beliefs to explain those internal mechanisms of our mind and replace it with theories that could be scientifically proven. And this really is the start of cognitive psychology. So behaviorism focuses on observable actions, behaviors. It's especially attuned to learning. Cognitive psychology is all about those internal mechanisms. And it is a massive perspective in psychology. It covers everything from intelligence to memory to thinking to biases to emotions to motivations, like you name it. It's a massive field in psychology. In fact, many videos that I'll be producing in this series is going to talk about cognitive psychology, far more than the ones I'll be producing on behaviorism. So these two are really the modern perspectives on psychology. And in fact, if you go back to the definition of what psychology is, the scientific study of mind and behavior, well, these two perspectives fulfill those two main aspects, right? Cognitive psychology is the mind or mental processes, and behaviorism is the behavior part. Now, I mentioned there's three perspectives that are part of the modern science. The third one is humanism. And it came along in about the mid part of the 20th century as well. Now, cognitive psychology, I mentioned, kind of replaced psychoanalytical perspective in psychology. Humanism didn't really replace anything. Really what it did was it shifted the focus of psychology. And what it did in shifting that focus is it made it more people-oriented. And I know that probably sounds kind of weird because you think, how could psychology not be people-oriented? But keep in mind, much of the history of psychology focused on studying mental processes, behaviors, by trying to categorize people, trying to see similarities that exist across many, many different people that really don't have much in common. Part of the byproduct of that is a tendency to kind of not see the uniqueness that we all have. Another big problem really with psychology up until the advent of humanism was that most of the time psychologists viewed their role as scientists. And parts of that are good, right? Because a scientist should be objective. They should have their diagnoses or treatments or therapies or beliefs rooted in facts and science. That's all good. But the downside was that oftentimes what we had was psychologists that viewed their patients not as being people that needed help, but as problems that needed to be fixed. And that really doesn't lend itself to a person seeking out help when they need help with mental health issues. So this is where humanism came in. Humanism focused much more on the individual. So it focused on things like self-confidence and motivation, self-esteem. Motivation is a really key part of the humanistic perspective. One psychologist in particular that was hugely influential in humanism is a man named Carl Rogers. And he developed philosophical ideas that kind of are the linchpin of modern therapies. So this is the idea that if you go to a psychologist for help, whether it's counseling or you have a psychological disorder that needs to be treated, that you can confide in that person, that they're not going to be judgmental, right? They're not going to say, oh, well, this is the way I would do it if I were you, right? That's not the role of a psychologist, is to live your life for you. The role of the psychologist is to help give you the tools you need so that you can make the right decisions in your life, right? So it's much more focused on you and the individual. That came from Carl Rogers. It came from humanism. Another interesting side note is that humanism actually is kind of the beginning of a branch in psychology that I'll talk about in a later video a little bit, called positive psychology. So positive psychology is really kind of a more proactive branch in modern psychology. So what I mean by proactive is when I talk about people going to a psychologist, usually it's you're going to a psychologist because you have a problem, right? Either a psychological disorder or you just are going through something, right? Maybe you're dealing with grief or anxiety or depression and you need help for it. Well, positive psychology kind of challenges this view because that's more reactive, right? You have a problem, so you go to a doctor, you go to a psychologist to help you with that. Positive psychology says, why should we wait for the problem to develop in the first place? It's kind of like that saying about like an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So why wait for people to develop an anxiety disorder? Why not give them the tools they need to live a happier, healthier life so that they never even have those problems develop in the first place? That's where positive psychology comes in. It's a really interesting branch in the modern science of psychology. So these three perspectives, humanism, cognitive psychology, and behaviorism, are really the three most relevant perspectives in psychology today. And again, psychoanalytical theory, there are many aspects to that perspective that are still around today, but by and large, many of the contributions made by psychoanalytical psychology have been largely replaced by cognitive.